I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. I'm glad to be here, and I'm glad to have you along as well. This series focuses a lot on business and economic development. It's important that our community have a conversation all the time about how we create opportunity for families, for individuals, how do we create economies that serve our community, that lead us towards the kinds of lives in the neighborhoods that we're in our households, that are productive, that are rewarding, and that acquire wealth. Wealth creation is a good thing. We need to talk about and develop the tools, the language, to explore and pursue wealth creation as individuals and as families and community. Well, the people I've assembled today for this meeting are specialists, people committed to, aware of, and conversant in the issue of wealth creation and business development. Mike Temali is the leader at the Neighborhood Development Center in St. Paul. It's an organization that works with small businesses, minority businesses, to help entrepreneurs move towards their dreams and to be successful in doing so. One of his colleagues and partners is Sharir, Ahmed, who's Neighborhood Development Center's Director of Business, the Business Lab, I think it is, at the NDC. As a disclosure, Sahir and I are working on the Inside News, McFarlane Media Business Development, so thank you for that. And my goal in doing that is to say that as we have these conversations, I want to be able to testify that it's important to get quality advice and counsel in developing and growing a business to the next level. Also here, a friend from a while back, Diane Paterson. She is the Associate Director of the Metro Small Business Development Center. Thank you, Diane, for being here. And two entrepreneurs, they are Roger Cummings. He's the creator, one of the founders of Juxtaposition. It's an arts-based business and community development organization in North Minneapolis, but a phenomenal model, a principled and high vision strategy for community building, for empowering the community. And Anthony Taylor, his business is called My Bike Project, but many people know Anthony Taylor as one of the guiding lights in the organization called the Major Taylor Bicycling Club. It's a chapter here in Minnesota and a national one that tries to have our people understand the joy of bicycling as a gateway to exploring health, as a gateway to exploring community, and as a gateway to understanding transit-oriented development. That's a big project right here in Twin Cities right now. So we'll talk about all of that. Let me start, though, with Mike and Diane. You guys are both in the business of identifying challenges and bringing solutions to individuals that want to be entrepreneurial. Mike, what does that mean for NDC, for Neighborhood Development Center?
Well, when we have entire neighborhoods and entire communities that over a number of decades have kind of lost a lot of small businesses, a lot of entrepreneurship due to everything from a freeway being built right through the middle of their neighborhood to folks moving out or whatever it may be. You have entire communities that then both lack a local economy, places to have a job, places to buy products, places to get your hair done, whatever. But you also lose role models because, as we know, if you're a business owner, people look up to you in the community. They draw upon your knowledge of finance, your knowledge of planning. All those things are key ingredients to being a role model, being a healthy community leader. And so these neighborhoods then have had a problem with an absence of those types of positive forces. And so at the Neighbor Development Center, what we've done for like 25 years now is work as hard as we possibly can with every neighborhood partner we can find, including some of these groups that you see here today, to identify people in those neighborhoods and in those communities that have maybe a strong aspiration to become an entrepreneur, to start a business, or maybe to grow one they already have, but maybe don't have the money, maybe have a little bit of rough credit, maybe don't have a role model of their own in business, and work with them in their own community to develop those networks, those skills, and get them started in their business. And then they stay in that neighborhood and in that community, grow the economy and grow the community through all the things I've mentioned here.
Diane, jump in here. Metro Small Business Development Center, what's the vision? What's the work? How do you bring value to the community?
Well, as a partnership with the University of St. Thomas, we bring small business technical assistance to our clients, and they do not have to be affiliated with St. Thomas. Like Mike expressed, a lot of times a challenge for the entrepreneurs is that access to capital. We work with a lot of businesses recently, baby boomers who want to sell their business, but the younger generation don't have the capacity to purchase it. Or we work with students even at the University of St. Thomas who have come up with incredible innovative ideas that they are challenged to move forward because, again, the lack of capital. So we work with them to develop their business plans, develop their plan for the future, and partner with neighborhood development and other organizations to find them that capital so that they can succeed, especially with this, the succession planning. It's become really, really important. And those businesses on Main Street, if there isn't somebody to buy them and to keep them moving forward, they will disappear. So that's become incredibly important.
That's kind of the story of streets like Broadway. That 25, 30, 40 years ago were vibrant, vital communities. I remember when I started Insight back in maybe 1968 or 9, I think, we did stories on the front page of the Insight magazine of the leaders of the West Broadway Business Association. And there was a guy named Gene Elston. They called him the Bard of West Broadway. Mm-hmm. But he was a promoter, and he talked about, you know, the future. But what happened instead was the future continued to disappear. For West Broadway, I think that area is in a mode of resurgence and renovation right now. But the problem is what you described, when there's no way to connect those who are leaving businesses to those who remain and who want to bring business, you have this gap that occurs. And so you need to be planful, right?
Exactly. And finding ways where from a access to capital, and in addition to some tax issues for the seller. How can you develop those plans and make the deal happen?
So Roger, jump in here. You have an organization called Juxtaposition. It's an arts organization. You've got several buildings, I think, in North Minneapolis that you are teaching and training and growing businesses and teaching people about business, all with art as a the product and subcontext, right? Talk about Juxtaposition, first of all, and then the vision of your organization.
So the model for Juxtaposition is we have a training component. And then we have four micro enterprises that we call labs. So we have a graphic design lab, we have an environmental design lab, we have a textile customization screen printing lab, and then a contemporary art public art lab. All those generate money. We employ about 70 young people from 10 to 22. We employ about 70 young people a year, and we employ about 22 working artists a year. And so we do things like create logos, create posters, business cards, murals, pocket parks, parklets, benches, things like that. The young people build skills. They get enough money in the household so that it hits kind of a tipping point for that household, and they're able to access things that they wouldn't normally be able to access with a limited income. So we generate probably about 300,000 a year off of these labs, and the goal is to be about 90% sustainable as far as earned income.
And so the goal in the process is to grow entrepreneurs as well. So
absolutely.
The people that you're teaching and training, not only are they artisans, but they are business people.
Absolutely. So like about 75% of what we do at Juxta comes out of the what we were doing in like high school. So we would do graphic design and customization of shirts and things like that, and being able to teach young people early what are the you have to look at materials, you have to look at labor, you have to look at overhead, and then you look at your profit, and how to keep books, what does inventory look like. So all those things I didn't know when I was young, and so to teach young people that I think helps them as they start to be independently lively.
How did you come to the awareness of the need to learn these things and to train yourself and to become the entrepreneur, the business owner, business person?
Oh, failure and like mistakes.
Great teacher, huh?
Yeah, underpricing your work, working too hard on one thing, not looking at timelines. All those fails got me to like where I'm at now, and then I can kind of teach young people the shortcuts, and not just young people, but just like people who are starting their businesses in and around the neighborhood, who are older than 22, for advice and things like that.
So talk about the neighborhood, West Broadway. I mentioned that I've been on West Broadway in the neighborhood. In fact, I started my business in North Minneapolis. I live in North Minneapolis, and in 1974, I worked for a printing company in Northeast Minneapolis. We launched Insight as a magazine. I bought it after a year and launched it as a newspaper in 76. But I've lived in North Minneapolis the entire time. And over the years, X number of people have worked for me, gone on to other jobs, back to school, have bought houses and cars and raised families. So I know the consequence and the impact, the positive impact of being a business owner, and plus the critical business I'm in, communication, I think is, I describe my business as the information infrastructure of our community, critical for all other elements to properly grow, integrate, and evolve to their best and highest selves. But West Broadway has been one of the areas that I've looked at and been around all this time. How do you describe West Broadway now, given what I said earlier about this period of decline and now resurgence?
So when we moved to West Broadway from an old spot in like 2002, renovated our first building at 2007 Emerson, there was abandoned buildings on either side of us. Emerge was abandoned. So from 2004, when we opened up on Broadway, to now, there's over $80 million in investment just in this four-block area. So, the Emerge building, Urban Homeworks, the school headquarters, the 1200 Breaking Bread building, all those started to come up, after like we moved in. So you're starting to see a resurgence in these different pockets. WBC is a part of that. A lot of people are playing parts in this investment in Broadway.
And one of the critical things in the future, Anthony Taylor, is transportation. The question of light rail in North Minneapolis and through the Southwest Line, I think it is, and what Broadway will play in that. You've been talking about transit-oriented development for a long time, not only looking at things like light rail and driving, but you think people have to also think about bicycles as a recreation, but bicycles as practical transportation, even for work or for school or for other purposes as well. You had a show on KMLJ just recently, on KFAI just recently, talking about transit-oriented development. How do you think our community should look at things like bicycle lanes and development around transportation needs?
Well, I think the big thing, and I think there's often one way our show yesterday was called Our Bike Lanes, White Lanes, because there's a very serious concern that the communities are being redeveloped for people that are coming and not for people that live there. So that's kind of the side that looks ominous and people are concerned about. From a development standpoint, what I'm seeing is that this is a monumental shift in terms of the motive of development right now, that people, urban planners, landscape architects, everyone is beginning to design, redesign, and redevelop their cities based on human impact. That's a huge shift. So what that means is we're designing these cities and redeveloping our communities based on how we're going to live, quality of life. And what people want to do is they want to bike to the store, they want to walk to the store, they want to walk to school, they want to have all these things in their community. In one city, Detroit has kind of coined the 20-minute neighborhood mm-hmm. as the idea. And so what I really see, and I think biking is a solution, what I really am seeing is that as we redevelop our neighborhoods based on how we want to live, what that means is we want businesses close by. We want the things that matter and have high value in terms of 5 to 9 and 9 to 5 close to home in the neighborhood. And so if we design cities and redesign our communities that they're bikeable, they're walkable, entrepreneurship flows from that because that is really a big idea, again, based on human impact. And so that's why I see biking as a key piece of this movement. That's why I see walking as a key piece of this, and I see business as a key piece of it. So that's where I believe we're headed right now.
Shahir, as you work with people like Al McFarlane, helping them devise a vision and a plan, what are the challenges that entrepreneurs face in moving their businesses either into reality or to the next level?
Well, what we find is a lot of micro entrepreneurs have a challenge with marketing and accounting. The financial health of their business. And so what we try to do as consultants is help them sit down and think about what's most important for their product or service, who their customer is, and then helping develop a plan around actionary tasks to get there. For instance, we'll have a client who is overpricing their product or service, and it's a disconnect to their actual customer that they should be having. Or we'll have to do some forensic accounting and bookkeeping for their books and their financials so that they can realize where their money's going. Mm-hmm. So we provide these types of services to help them be more practical, be more efficient in a day-to-day basis, all while stepping back and saying, where do I want to go in the next 3 years? How do I get there? And we find that marketing and financial health is the two keys that they need.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. Our conversation is about business and economic development, neighborhood business development. One of the things that you'll be noticing in my newspaper, Insight News, over the next several months is a lot of covers that are presenting art and local artists. And due to a conversation I had earlier with Roger Cummings and Mahmoud Al-Qadi, we decided to dedicate for a number of weeks and perhaps months the covers of Insight News to local artists. And the thought is that it makes sense to lead with art. Artists have a particular and powerful role in developing, they have a freedom to express a truth that is not beholden to anybody. And we want to be able to present that freedom as a rallying point for our communities to think of ourselves as entrepreneurs. We'll talk more about that in just a minute. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. The topic is business development, community development. I mentioned before the break that Insight News is going to be presenting art and artists. The vision, the concept is that we're going to lead with art. The newspaper is, but the suggestion is that the community leads with art. And Roger Cummings, Juxtaposition, this idea is inspired by my previous interview with you and Mahmoud Al-Qadi. That artists have the freedom to speak truth to power. And at some point in time, I believe our obligation is to encourage our entire community to speak with the same kind of freedom and the same kind of confidence. What do you think about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So, like, I stand on the shoulders of, like, people like Satu Jones and Toowoomba Akin, and so this is, like, a continuation of that and seeing how they're able to impact the built and natural environment in ways a lot of people cannot, like having access to, creating opportunities for, I think being able to experiment a lot. So research and development is a part of being an artist, being a trickster is a part of being an artist, and then also being an entrepreneur is that too. So those are all the things that that are all encompassed in art. It's not just painting pretty pictures, but it's making a livelihood and being able to contribute to your neighborhood, to your broader community, and bring people in so they can do that as well.
Anthony, jump in there, and because you've talked about, you've been an advocate about economic development and business creation and finding different ways to express, you know, to explore points of entry.
And I think that the issue of art, I mean, what I think is interesting, when you, I think the thing that I found with artists is that it's an intrinsic commitment to actually experience, interpret, you know, what's happening in the community in that way. And so even the work that we're doing right now around, you know, I think in a simple way, we're talking about biking. Actually, it's interesting. I have actually been talking to Roger a lot about this idea. I believe that we have to take biking and active transportation and not make it about the bike, right? That we have to do it in a way where it actually is an expression in the community. That if there is a, there's a special way that walking and biking moves you, and it's not through a community, but actually in a community. That's really that you can drive through a community, you bike and walk in a community, and you see it and feel it in a very different way. And so for us to, you know, I really feel like I'm taking cues from what Juxta has done in an amazing way in Northside, which is I want to create a bike movement and an experience around biking and walking that actually is that same thing. It becomes an expression of the community, an expression of the people, and our goal is to get people to revitalize, reclaim, rediscover, reinvigorate the communities they live in, you know, one bike ride at a time.
I know you've talked about this phenomenon national, and you're creating it locally, called slow rolling, right? And just the idea itself is appealing, because if you are older and haven't been on the bike for a long time, you might be intimidated by the idea of all these people in racing gear, you know, flying down the bikeway. But it doesn't have to be that way, and you're creating an environment that invites everybody multi-generationally to get out and just cruise. You know, and there's something cultural about that. It reminds you of stepping to a degree. There's something artistic and dancing and breathing and life-affirming about the slow rolling movement. And you're thinking that it's also reflective of a capacity to engage in business as well.
Well, and I think that, absolutely, I think slow roll, which evolved out of Detroit, one of the immediate outcomes of that was the fact that people in communities rediscovered businesses in their community. Again, this idea of being able to bike and walk. Right now, I guarantee you, there are people who live north, love north, and through our bike rides, we have reintroduced them to great coffee, great food, great music, great art. This blocks away from the places they live. And so really that idea, people always talk about the dollar recirculating in a community. So that's what we really see this as a possibility. It literally is gonna recirculate, because on this bike ride, they're gonna rediscover a place they can take their child, a place where they can buy a great t-shirt, a place where they can get a great coffee, a great dinner. Their school is in the neighborhood. And then we'll hopefully introduce new entrepreneurs on a weekly basis to this community as well. And so that's really our intent around why we wanna do a bike ride and why we wanna do a slow roll.
So, Sharir, you know, one of the things that I have been concerned about is how do we change the perception of who we are? As a communicator, I believe that my job, my role with artists, for example, is to project the notion that we are, by nature, an entrepreneurial people. How do we create that discussion where we have brought language, brought a vocabulary, into common use, where the exchanges that we do among each other reflect a core business transactional economic awareness and value and benefit? What do you think?
I think that the entrepreneur has to find a sense of self-brand and knowing who they are and what they bring to the table, taking ownership for who they are, their product and service and their connection to the community. What's important to them and to their family, their children. I mean, that's who they bring. That's part of their brand. You can have a pencil you're selling, but it's really who you are behind that the customer is going to continue to come back, and that's the impact that's going to be in the community. And then communicating effectively, finding ways, you know, using technology, you know, apps and all the other social media platforms that we use today to communicate who we are and who your brand is on an effective basis. some other ideas, I think, that entrepreneurs are, that are consistent with being in the community and connecting and having a good, solid brand is networking. I think building relationships, as we're doing here, as organizations network. But if we're talking about biking and walking in the neighborhood, you're going to be able to network. You're going to bump into someone who you may have not seen in a while. And I think that that reinforcement of what are you doing today, what have you been doing, how is your business, what's the successes, what are the pitfalls of your business, and sharing those stories, that goes beyond just, hey, I have something to sell. And then, you know, just making a positive impact, being present. Is something that the youth need. They need to see positive role models. And we as adults, and as we talked about the baby boomers earlier, you know, who's going to have that brand and take on that next, the baton, and have that and be a positive role model. So
Mike, you talked early on about neighborhoods that don't have a lot of people in businesses, or neighborhoods whose business base was depleted by policy political or business strategy, namely the freeways wiped out the black business sector in St. Paul. Things are changing now. How do we get back what we lost and go beyond that? And that's kind of what you do, I think.
It is, and I think it's what we all do here. So much of I think what we're all talking about is helping people have belief in themselves as an individual and in their own community, so that they're not looking outside of themselves or outside of their family for success, but believe and know that they can be successful, whether it's as an artist or an outdoors person or a business owner or as a lawyer or a media mogul, themselves. And I think when we have a culture that was depleted, or a community that was depleted not just of businesses but of role models, of professional neighbors, of successful adults, then those kids are all either looking at bad role models and bad options, or they're looking at options that are just really remote and hard to achieve, like becoming the next Prince or Michael Jordan, which some of them might be. Mm-hmm. But if we can sort of repopulate rebuild the confidence and boldness of our community, starting with the kids, that these two fellows do. I love that we're sitting at the same table here, because it all starts with the kids. There's no end and no limit to what can emerge, because it's the creative process that each entrepreneur has to have to figure out, what is their brand, what is their product, what are they passionate about. We have barbers in St. Paul at the grooming house. You might not think being a barber is that glamorous. You go into the grooming house at University in Dale and it blow you away. Both the sort of hipness of it, but also the vibe, the community, the energy. And you multiply that by hundreds and hundreds of these little businesses. Golden Time Coffee or Big Daddy's Barbecue over on University in Dale are just some that come to my mind. They have rebuilt a confidence in Frogtown and some university in the African-American community in St. Paul, that this is something that those kids can aspire to just by observing and by going in and buying something once in a while.
University is really popping up again. All the new apartment, multifamily dwellings right on the light rail line. Talk about that. I mean, is that what was predicted, and have the predictions fulfilled the expectations of both residents and businesses that were part of the university community as this new development took place?
I think it's a 100-year investment, so we'll see in 100 years what the ultimate impact was. But you know what? I think the way that Green Line was built, after quite a bit of struggle, mm-hmm. and quite a bit of kicking and fussing from the community levels, came out with a remarkable and kind of national example of how to do a $1 billion project differently, in a way that, they had the three missing stops, that they weren't gonna stop in the neighborhoods that right. needed it the most. They changed that, and to be honest, it was Barack Obama, when he came into office, that really allowed that to happen. The foundations all stepped up, the city stepped up, but it was really driven by the community and the vision, mm-hmm. and they had artists engaged in I think, literally hundreds of locations for all different types of art. They closed the street for Safe Street, whatever they call that day when you can walk and bike and so on. And contrary to our greatest fears, the small businesses did not get wiped out. And the ethnic businesses did not get wiped out. And so there was a very, remarkably low level of businesses lost. And in the meantime, the Neighbor Development Center and Shahir's department in particular worked, I think, with 400 of these little businesses to help them rebrand, to get engaged on social media and the internet and so on to kind of get into the next century with their branding and marketing. And I think they're being rediscovered now, and the light rail project has been a boost for that.
So, Diane, as we're moving into a new political arena, we refer to, the benefit that came from President Obama, but the intuitive sense of the Republican presidency suggests that there ought to be huge opportunity for the business sector, whether that's going to be just for the moguls or for businesses up and down the spectrum, who knows. Should we be looking at the current political environment as an opportunity-rich environment, or should small business owners and community people thinking about becoming entrepreneurs be cautious, be wary? What do you think?
I think it's a time for opportunity. I know that some small businesses really struggle with high levels of regulation. And there has been talk that some of that regulation will be diminished. But because a lot is unknown, especially on the federal level, even our representatives and senators don't know what the budget will be. And so there is a lot of uncertainty. From a state level, and looking at the budget that they are discussing right now, we've really seen some cuts in small business spending from the Minnesota Investment Fund, Jobs Creation Funds, all of that funding went away. And that's, we know as we work with small businesses, that's the backbone. That's who is bringing about new employment. So I would like to see that level of in the budget increased because it is. It's what creates the jobs, and those jobs stay. So there is a lot of uncertainty. I do think that overall there is a great deal of opportunity. Again, from a state level, Minnesota ranked 47th as far as of the states for new business development, and I would like to see that change. And what can we do as a state to take us from 47th to top five? Because that's really important for the community.
So Mike, what are the policy challenges? What do we need to do in terms of getting policy that supports business development coming from the state house or counties?
There was a good step made last session with the equity funding that put $35 million both into workforce development and into small business development. And that actually, particularly the small business side of that, received support from both sides of the aisle. And so hopefully we can recognize, not just in the Twin Cities, but statewide, the need for helping, people step up with their own skills, their own energy, put their own house on the line, put their own life on the line, but with their idea for a business, and that the state would put a little bit more backing to that. The equity gap we have in our state is not going to get solved in one bill and in one year. Everybody knows it's a very damning statistic and reality that has to change. And so the legislature ultimately controls the biggest purse. There's plenty of good folks ready to act and to keep acting, but we're all always tight on money, and the legislature's, I think, where it's got to come from.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We're talking about business and economic development, talking about the neighborhood and entrepreneurship. When we come back, we'll round it up. I want to ask each of my guests to do some dreaming about what outcomes we seek that are desirable, how the beautiful community, the effective economic and vital community would look and how we, in our current efforts, are moving in that direction. Stay tuned. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. I want to ask my guest to sort of state the case for continued investment in small business support and in creating resources for small business. Mike Temali and Diane Paterson, you've both got a track record of serving people. Let's tell what the story has been and where you go from here.
Well, thank you. So in our 23 years of history, we have provided an extensive training class of 20 weeks long to almost 5,000 individuals out in all these like dozens of different communities to write a business plan for their own idea, of which probably 1,000 have started a business. They don't all last forever, but they do last, in our case, on average, almost 10 years, which is better than the national average by 100%, actually. We have financed over $18 million of their dreams, and none of those folks at that point were able to go to a bank and get a nickel. And so by putting $18 million on the street, including $5.5 million for African-American entrepreneurs in that period of time, we have put fuel behind their dream, because it doesn't pay to teach people how to write a business plan for their own dream if they can't finance the thing. And so we've been able to do that. And then once they're in business, we provide, I think, 5,000 hours a year of individual technical assistance through Sharir's department. This is lawyers and accountants and branding folks and everybody else, restaurant experts. But all this costs money, obviously. From a policy level, from a funders level. We get fantastic support, by the way, from local foundations and corporations and so on. Starting to get some individual support. As of a year ago, we had about 430 people in business, open businesses, and they were paying $6 million a year just to the state of Minnesota in taxes. They're putting out actually about $75 million a year in general in their annual expenditures. Mm-hmm. Of which $6 million goes to the state of Minnesota for property taxes. They have a payroll aggregate of $25 million. And almost all of that is located right in the heart of Frogtown and the east side of St. Paul, North Minneapolis and South Minneapolis. So that's a nice shot of both economic impact. There's 2,500 employees, mm-hmm. by the way, mm-hmm. Mostly neighborhood residents. And so that just radiates out. I mean, it's a ripple effect. And again, all these owners of these businesses become leaders at the church, at the school, at the rec center, using their business knowledge to help other things in the community.
Diane, same story. What's been the history of your organization, the Metro Small Business Development Center?
Well, the Small Business Development Center is a national program, and we have 9 regional centers throughout the state of Minnesota. From a funding standpoint, the Small Business Development Center is always a partnership between the federal SBA and an organization of higher education. In the instance of the Metro SBDC, it's a partnership between the University of St. Thomas and the SBA, which allows us then to have an expert staff that we pay but then offer our services to the entrepreneurs for free. So it's a great resource. Because we have a paid staff, we have the continuity and the ability to bring in expertise in a variety of areas. Our goal at the SBDC is long-term relationships. So get the business started, find them the necessary capital, whether it's a bank loan or partnering with NDC, but then stay with them so that we can assure their sustainability and viability by offering them services and resources as their business grows. So it could be social media after they have launched. It could be accounting services. We have CPAs on staff. It could be through a growth initiative. Their operations plan is now out of date. They don't have the organizational chart, or they don't have the right people in the right seats. And so we have organizational professionals on staff as well. So on average, we see about 500 new businesses a year, and provide 5,000 hours of technical assistance. We have a shorter training course that we offer once a month, titled Smart Start for Business. And that's for entrepreneurs in the ideation stage. I think I want to start this business. And we cover a comprehensive level of starting with legal form of business and tax implications to risk management and regulatory compliance, marketing strategies. Pricing strategies is a big one for new entrepreneurs. Typically, they underprice themselves. And so we go through that process prior to them sitting down one-on-one with one of our consultants. But I think it's really key to have that resource throughout the different phases of the business to better ensure their success.
Is there enough service like this in the marketplace right now, Mike? Are you able to reach all the people that you want to reach? How do we grow your capacity? Diane, how do we grow the capacity of your organization to connect with and to nurture entrepreneurs?
The answer is no, there's not enough of this available. And a big issue is people's awareness of what resources are. And we're not the only two groups in the Twin Cities doing this. So Women Ventures does a great job, Latino Economic Development Center, MEDA, and the Minneapolis Consortium, et cetera. So there's a handful of groups. It's kind of a small industry. And in general, we're all overloaded. It's almost, you get the feeling it's almost an infinite need. I mean, we have entrepreneurs sitting at every of our staff's desks almost all day long unless they're out in their shops. So, and we're not trying to run anybody's business for them. We're just trying to give them some basics so that they can enter the mainstream, be bankable, go pay their own accountant, pay their own lawyer, et cetera. So none of this is about subsidizing the business. It's about guiding them out of the woods so they can become successful. And so more resources, but you know, we also internally need to always do better. We have to have high quality work. We have to have good inter-organizational communications and partnerships. So there's plenty we can do. But you know, we're young, right? Or some of us. So we'll keep getting better.
How do you grow, Diane? How do you grow your ability to serve the need, meaning support people who want to become entrepreneurial, who want to bring products, services to market?
When Mike said it, you know, a lot of it is visibility and letting the entrepreneurs know that these resources are available. Partnering as economic development organizations, you know, Mike mentioned the other partnerships that we have. One other organization that we partner with, in fact, we brought them to St. Thomas now, their offices is Legal Corps, which is a pro bono business transactional service for those who need legal advice, patents, et cetera. So understanding what the expertise are of our economic development partners, if it's a loan, it could be MEDA, it could be NDC, it could be the consortium, and handing off those clients to those other organizations where that can address their particular challenges. But the biggest part is outstate. We do have resources, not enough in the metro. But outside of the metro is particularly challenging for entrepreneurs. The resources are there, but again, the visibility and the knowledge that they do exist is not as high as it could be.
Let me focus on opportunity right now. I have described North Minneapolis as a kind of a huge empty space. It doesn't have density, but density is coming. I see density coming back to the Midway area in St. Paul with a high number of multifamily units being developed along the Green Line on University Avenue. I think policy and interest level right now are focused on how do we build North Minneapolis and create two things. One, again, an exceptional community, but do that without shipping out those who live there? How do you do this without displacing black people and poor people who have been there for a long time? How do you create opportunity for them to be earning and contributing and growing their families and their neighborhoods and being participants and customers in a vibrant local retail and service business industry? And so when it comes to vision, you know, Roger and Anthony, what do you envision? How do you see what would be the optimum set of outcomes? If you closed your eyes and sort of explored and described the picture in your mind's eye, how do you see, what picture do you paint, Roger, for North Minneapolis and places like that, our neighborhoods?
I think housing is going to be a big thing. I know there's a lot of outside interests that are buying a lot of housing. I think that's something that needs to be addressed along the corridor, the different parcels. You know, who owns them? How can people who live in the neighborhood acquire those? City policy. RFPs, RFQs, I think making that more transparent, I think is going to be a key in that. So there's like a lot of systems things that I think would need to go in place for people not to be culturally displaced, economically displaced, physically displaced. And not just any investment, but specific investment, targeted investment in some of these things. So, yeah.
What does equity sound like to you? Equity, our community, black people having real ownership in the neighborhood. Housing, the recent housing crisis further eroded the wealth of the black community. I think in the past year or two, reports indicate blacks in Minnesota actually suffered a decline in wealth. At the same time, the nation was recovering and growing in wealth for ordinary Americans in Minnesota. And this is in progressive Minnesota. And in liberal Minnesota, our communities suffered a loss of wealth. And a lot of that had to do probably with either jobs and or ownership of houses and equity, et cetera, like that. How do we get past that, Anthony? How do we sort of reshift and refocus our community and our mind to claim what we want and who we are and how we grow it?
Well, so the good news is the bad news, and in some ways, one of the things we have to accept is that the current state of what we're experiencing is not part of the character of the people, that the disparities we see are actually the result of historical, intentional public policy driven by financial policy. It's really hard to acknowledge that. So if we acknowledge that, then now we're down to the good news. It was public policy. It was intentional. These were measurable outcomes. And so we can recreate that. And so it's going to have to be an intersectional, focused set of public policy and financial investment and the use of organizations moving towards this vision of that does include housing, does include transportation, does include job development and economic development and education and healthcare. And so an intersectional approach of that, with the understanding that we created this, we'll begin to get us out of it. And then in terms of equity, the piece that I'm really fighting for is that we do the work inside the community so they fight for it, so there is a boom around creative small housing, right? The community isn't fighting for that yet. It's coming, right? The density is an opportunity. How do we help if it is an opportunity, how does the community begin to see it as an opportunity and fight for the right kind of density, right? Multimodal transportation, bikeability, walkability, if that is an opportunity, what do we do to help the community understand it in a way so that they begin to fight for these things in a way that supports their vision for the community? And the ultimate vision of this is that we have multi-generational home ownership, handing down of building of wealth, that we and I don't know if this is a word, but we end the isolation of North Minneapolis, that was created by transportation strategy, transportation policy. That's just real, and that it is something that really includes a foundational vision for the way the community sees itself. And the last piece, I'll borrow from my mother, is that in doing this, and I really think Roger said something really important, the idea of culture, cultural displacement. that we see culture as a foundational asset as we do all of this work. And I think that we'll have something really beautiful to look back at in 50 to 100 years, because that's really important. This is not next year. This is a 100-year program, right?
If I could pick up on another thing Roger said was the investment in the buildings. There was a RFP, a request for proposal, that the city of Minneapolis put out 12 years ago for the empty Sears Tower on Lake Street and Chicago Avenue. It was 1 million square foot. It sat empty for 10 years, towering over Phillips and Powderhorn Park. When they put that RFP out to developers, because of community input and community pressure, they required all developers interested in that building to incorporate into a redevelopment plan how would the community, the entire diverse community around there, be able to come inside that building on a daily basis for the next 100 years. And don't reply to this RFP if you can't figure that out. Like, in other words, don't build a fortress here. Because of that one sentence they put into their RFP, the Neighbor Development Center and our partner groups, including the Cultural Wellness Center, were able to build the Midtown Global Market, which now for 11 years almost has given the community an opportunity to start a business, get a job, and shop and hang out and have a community gathering place. Well, up on West Broadway, there's four, five, or six properties that are kind of in that RFP stage, or the thinking stage. And I know the West Broadway Coalition that you mentioned has a vision to build out their farmers market into a food hub in one of these buildings. The county, Hennepin County, owns most of that property. So how they write this request for proposals right now, like you were saying, is key, because they could make it such that no neighborhood vision ever gets a chance to emerge in that property, or they could make it the opposite. So the real estate part of this is really key, and if you don't have your eye on that, the culture and the people are going to lose out. I mean, they're not going to be there.
And that's why I'm saying it is intentional. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That this is our intent.
Without a doubt.
We write in the intent, we make it solid and clear, we will have different outcomes. And again, that's exciting. I think the Midtown Global Market is a great example of that. Even to the point of ownership.
Right.
The hour goes so fast. I think we're out of time, but I want to thank all of you for being here. Thanks to my guest today. An important conversation, one that will continue in weeks to come. Mike Temali is the head of Neighborhood Development Center in St. Paul. His colleague, Sharir Ahmed, works as the director of the Business Lab at NDC. Diane Paterson is associate director of Metro Small Business Development Center. Roger Cummings, the creator, co-founder, I think, of Juxtaposition, a phenomenal arts-based entrepreneurial venture in North Minneapolis. And my friend, Anthony Taylor, you know him from the Major Taylor Bicycle Club, among other things, also some other businesses you've had, but his new business is My Bike Project. I know you as a champion for transit-oriented development, for healthful living, and as an advocate and spokesperson for bringing our culture as an asset into the equation of developing community. Well, I want to thank all of you for being here. I want to thank you for watching the program. Stay tuned. We'll talk more in the future about business development in our community. I'm Al McFarland, and this is Conversations with Al McFarland. That's it.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say good night. We want to thank Al McFarland for bringing us all those great words, and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to keep it nice clear.